Hi, my name's Kyle McDonald, and I'm a PhD student in developmental psychology at Stanford University. And in this video, I'm going to be talking to you about a fundamental component of human psychology called theory of mind. But first, let's start with an important question. How do we know what other people are thinking? After all, we have no way of directly observing what's going on inside of their heads. But what we can do is observe other people's actions and use this information to make guesses about what they're thinking. One intuitive example is when we see a stranger waving at us. We might guess at things like whether or not he knows me, he wants me to wave back, or maybe he's not actually waving to me at all, but waving at someone behind me. And what's important is that we make all these inferences quite easily and quite rapidly. Philosophers and researchers have called this general process of theorizing about other people's mental states a theory of mind. Broadly defining it as the ability to attribute beliefs, desires, and knowledge to oneself and to others, with the understanding that other people can have mental states that are different from your own. But what does it mean to have a theory of mind? And how does it work in the real world? Well, just like theories in science, having a theory of mind allows you to explain other people's behavior and to make predictions about what they will do in new situations. So for example, if you see someone choose to eat chocolate ice cream, you'll explain their behavior as an internal preference for chocolate. And you can now use this part of theory of mind to predict that they might be likely to select chocolate ice cream over, say, mint chip in the future. And it's easy to think about how explaining and predicting behavior would be a useful skill across many different situations. But what does theory of mind look like in kids? Well, similar to most skills, children need time and experience with the world to develop their theory of mind abilities. One good example of children's immature theory of mind comes from games of hide-and-go-seek, where children will often hide in plain sight but cover their eyes. In this scenario, the child has failed to consider that just because he can't see, it doesn't mean that other people around him can't see as well. This makes for a short and uneventful game. It's from these kinds of behaviors that it's clear that children's theory of mind abilities are still developing, and researchers have come up with clever methods to measure these changes. One classic task is the false belief test. In this game, children meet two characters, Bobby and Susie. Bobby has a green box and Susie has a blue box. Then Bobby takes one of his toys and puts it inside of the green box before leaving the room to go for a walk. Susie then takes the toy and moves it from the green box to the blue box. After this change of location, Bobby comes back and wants to play with his toy. And the child is asked, where will Bobby look for his toy? The prediction here is that children who understand that Bobby could hold a false belief will say that he will look in the green box where he last saw his toy. Whereas children who do not have this understanding will say that he'll look in the blue box, failing to appreciate Bobby's false belief. Using this method, researchers have found a robust developmental pattern where 3-year-olds tend to fail and 4-year-olds reliably pass. And this finding has led to theoretical accounts that emphasize a strong conceptual shift in children's theory of mind abilities. But is there evidence of earlier false belief understanding in infancy? And how might we go about measuring this? In a recent experiment, Christine Onishi and René Baillargeon created a false belief task more appropriate for infants. To do this, they used a violation of expectation paradigm that leverages infants' looking times as a measure of their surprise. In their task, they first familiarized infants to an adult hiding and retrieving a toy from two boxes. Then, in phase two, the toy was moved from one box to the other. The critical manipulation was that in the true belief condition, the adult could see that the toy changed locations. But in the false belief condition, her eyes were covered, and therefore she could not see that the toy moved. In the test phase, infants either saw the adult reach into the box where the toy was or was not located. And the key prediction is that infants should look longer when the adult performs a surprising action, either by reaching to the incorrect location in the true belief condition, even though she knew where the toy was, or by reaching to the correct location in the false belief condition, even though she had not seen the toy being moved there. What they found was that there were longer looking times in both the true belief and the false belief condition, depending on whether or not the adult performed a surprising reach. With these results suggesting that toddlers may already have some understanding that other people act on the basis of their beliefs, and that these beliefs may or may not accurately reflect the true state of the world. So how do we explain preschoolers' failures on classic false belief tasks when infants seem to show this basic understanding of other people's beliefs? One possibility is that there are two systems in play, an implicit and explicit theory of mind, with the implicit system being learned early or innate, and the explicit system being learned more slowly. Another possibility is complete continuity in children's theory of mind abilities. In this explanation, preschoolers' failures are seen as artifacts of experimental tasks that are too difficult for the child to understand. While the current evidence suggests complete continuity account is more likely, no one study has provided conclusive evidence, and this research is ongoing. So to wrap up, we started with a big question. How do we take observable behavior and turn it into rich inferences about what other people are thinking? And we learned that people have a set of tools called theory of mind that allows them to reason about other people's goals, beliefs, and desires, which in turn allows them to explain behavior and make predictions about what other people will do in the future. Finally, we saw that children's theory of mind skills are developing in the first years of life, but there is evidence for early false belief understanding if the task is simple and slow enough for toddlers to understand. It's important to point out that there are active debates about the best way to characterize our theory of mind capabilities, and not all researchers think that we use actual theories to interpret other people's behavior. However, we can conclude that most often we are able to rapidly figure out what other people have in their heads that causes them to do the things they do, which is pretty cool. That's all. Thanks for watching.